Started. I'd like to welcome Brenda and Amber. They're going to talk about their project, a charitable trust in New Zealand, and they plan to have some time at the end to answer some questions. We do have a couple microphones that we'll bring around so you can ask questions, don't provide statements, just ask questions, please. And so save your questions to the end. Thank you for coming.
Cool. So we wanted to come and have a chat to you about a project that we've been doing that has only recently become into a charity in New Zealand. So we'll just kick off, and this is kind of our story and how we got to do it. Is it a little echoey? So let's start with what's important. So who we are. Tēnā koutou katoa. Tuatahi, ngā mihi, ki ngā tangata whenua o tēnei rohi. Ara ngā tangata mui nina, nā rātou te mana me te kaitiakitanga o tēnei wahi. Ko Tararua te pai māna, ko te whanganui a tāra oku moana, ko Purahau, ko Wairarapa te roto, ko Mua Upoko, ko Rangatane, ko Kahu, Nanu, ki Wairarapa, oku iwi, ko Papawai, ko Hirunui o Rangi, oku marae. Ko Amber Craig, tōku ingoa. Nō reira, tēnā koutou, tēnā koutou, tēnā koutou katoa.
Tōku mihi. Ko whakakahu te monga, ko wakato te awa, ko pokane te marae, nō whakamaru ia hau, ko Brenda, tōku ingoa. Okay, so we just introduced ourselves.
In te reo Māori.
In te reo Māori, and in it includes not just our name comes near the end, but where we're from, the river, the mountain.
My mountain, the ocean that I whakapapa to.
And we included an acknowledgement of country in te reo Māori, and we did that first because that felt right.
And we're now going to do it in English. So I pay respect to the traditional and original owners of this land, the Mui Nina people.
To pay respect to those who have passed before us and to acknowledge today's Tasmanian Aboriginal community who are the custodians of this land.
Cool.
So there's us, being giant.
So to start with, Brenda's going to lead a little bit of a pronunciation on what our project's name actually is.
She's going to judge me as I do this. Okay, this is Whare Hauora. So whare means house, dwelling, building. Hauora means wellness, so it means healthy house. Who wants to join me? There's heaps of Kiwis, we can just do this. Come on. Okay, whare, let's do it. Whare, and then hauora. Hauora. There we go, you just said healthy house.
And the great thing I love about hauora is it's not just about being healthy, it's about the overall wellness. So it's mental health, it's spiritual health, it's your physical health and your family health. And so I just wanted to as well thank Ian Cormack, who helped us with this name. So this is an official Te Reo Māori name for our charity, and we've had official sign-off. So
cool. You can't just take a name. All right, so I'm going to tell a story. This is my daughter, and she's homesick from school yet again with asthma. And we lived in a rental. This is a really common story in New Zealand. And I wanted to work out why she was getting asthma. There are lots of variants. There's some pollen from some flowers, maybe that was it. Viruses, there's dampness, there's mold. And I wanted to measure my house. So I bought one of these. These are $300 New Zealand dollars off the Apple store, a Netatmo. And I put it in my house and got some measurements. But I didn't want to spend $300 on every room in my house. I did the measurements. I've got my slides out of order, but hey, I did the measurements. You can see the red is the highest temperature I recorded, and the blue is the lowest for each day. And you can see round about New Zealand's winter in July, it's getting pretty cold in my house. So here's some World Health Organization standards that I compared my rental house to. And this is the badness. Even though I'm not home when it gets cold, it's now got conditions for growing mold when I'm not home and not heating my house. So having so much below the minimum healthy warm standard of a house was why there was mold growing in my house. So, And here's the same thing for humidity. You can and see in Wellington, the ambient humidity this time of year is usually around 80%. And we get the same inside the house. So mold loves it in New Zealand. So I didn't want to spend $300 on every room in my house. So I got about $30 worth of bits that I happen to have lying around. And this is my first pass on a breadboard with a transmitter and a receiver. They were awful, but they worked. And I got a few of these going around the house. And I was able to start taking control and understanding the different rooms in my house, what's on the north, what's on the south, which ones are damp, which are dry. And I thought, I wanted to buy a house. And also, so I was saving all the money in the world, because it costs all the money in the world to buy a house these days. And I wanted to know that having spent all this money, I would end up with a house that was better. This graph came out of some software, some open source stuff that I rigged up. And you can see there's my bedroom looking reasonably warm and comfortable. And there's my daughter's. And it was in the shadow. You can see the saw, that's the heater kicking in, the thermostat. So it heats, it goes down, heats, it goes down. And the heater would turn off when we left the house. And a little while after we had left, it would just get really cold and dip below the minimum standards again. This is a phrase that I love. And through all my engineering career, I've used this. What is measured gets managed. If you haven't measured it, you're not going to manage it. Or you're going to manage something that isn't even bad in the first place. So I just wanted to measure all the things.
So Brenda came and then had a chat to me about some of her projects. When we had a coffee chat about it, we kind of asked, is this a problem for other people? So we kind of had a look into it, and heck yes, it is. So a third of New Zealand homes are cold or damp, and we actually have a Professor Philippa Howden Chapman, who is in Wellington, I believe, who's doing a lot of study and feeding into the World Health Organization standards. So we also have this thing called the New Zealand Building Code Standard. And the third edition in May 2007 came out and added an energy efficiency section. And that basically says that you should have insulation in your house. So I then kind of took some of those details. And I then looked at the statistics New Zealand around the new housing standards and how many houses have that. So the top bar is actually the total number of houses in 2016. The green in the second bar is actually how many of those houses existed pre that insulation standard coming into effect. So the difference is roughly around 10% of houses were really only built with this new insulation standard mandated, which is really interesting. And then when you look at cold and damp houses and that they lead to respiratory issues, this is from the Asthma Foundation New Zealand, in which they talk about how one in six Kiwis are affected, 700,000 people, 5.5 billion, and it is, I didn't even realize this, the third leading cause of death in New Zealand. So we thought about how we could help others. And we have a Gina Rangi, who is a Māori businesswoman entrepreneur, and this was a great quote she had in an interview with a magazine. And for those that don't know, ko papa is a process or a plan or kind of a purpose of what you're doing in a project. So Brenda and I kind of talked, and then we kind of brought our friend in, Hiria, as well. And we were like, if we were going to do this for other people, what kind of organization would we look to set up? So we decided right from the beginning that we wanted a very clear goal. We were going to be a charity. We're not doing this for money. Anything that we would do, we would put back into the company to be able to serve people. Ko hema tau e ki toku tūpuna tānei i te taha o toku whaia. He uri e no te rangatera, a i haia tau e ki koina tera e hainatia o te titiriti o Waitangi. So, this gentleman here is actually my great-great-great-grandfather, and he signed this document here, which is the Treaty of Waitangi. And for those that don't know, the Treaty of Waitangi is an Indigenous document that was signed between the Crown in the UK and some Māori chieftains in the North Island, not all of them, And it's a document that exists today and is acknowledged. And so when we set up the charity, it was very important for us that we also looked at how the charity would honour this document. We wanted to focus on people. In Te Reo Māori, there's a great saying. It's he aha te mea nui o te ao, he tangata, he tangata, he tangata. What is the most important thing in the world? It is the people, it is the people, it is the people. And so we kind of took this as well while we were looking at our charity. And we've been working through with pretty much everyone around us that we can to talk about how they're affected. We're looking at social housing in the suburbs that we're in and how we can look to build this. But while we're building it, teach students how to actually put Arduino kits together and get them to actually start building it within their communities and putting it in their own houses.
So that was a lot about why and how, this is what. So we want to work with the people in New Zealand who live in the dampest homes. But at the same time, we don't want to assume that we know what they want. We're going to offer, and for those that want it, they can have it. For those that tell us no, we stop. For those that say do it differently, we do it differently. So this is our first thing. This is this word, whakawhanaunatanga, is the process of establishing a relationship. We're really early in this, right? We've started to start the process of getting to know each other and turning up and saying, hey, we can build this. Is this what you want?
But it's also about not just turning up and going, hey, we have a solution for you that's going to solve everything.
We have arrived from on high with what you need. No, we're not doing that.
But it's actually about going to them and relating to their stories and then seeing if we can, with this solution, help them. So data sovereignty is also very important to us. So we kind of have also started to work on a data privacy policy. So we are very much within this charity for the residents. We're not for the landlords. We're not for the government. We're for the people who live in the house. So we collect what we need and we protect it and we anonymise it when shared. So what we want to do is take this data, anonymise it in suburbs and be able to show suburb versus suburb who actually has cold and damp houses. So rather than estimating, let's actually have real data that we can use. And we wanted the tech to kind of be a byproduct. So we wanted it to be able to support. It shouldn't be hard or expensive. This stuff exists today and we kind of want it to be able to be used by people, so we think user experience is quite important during this whole process.
Sure. All right. The future is here, it's just not evenly distributed, and I think that's my part of my motivation here. I can afford a $300 sensor and then I can take control. Those who can't afford it couldn't, so we're going to try and make this little part of technology more evenly distributed. So, okay, whare sensors, this is what we are building. Next slide. This is a photo. This is the gateway, you might recognize this. This is the cheap hardware you can get off AliExpress, plus some boards that we printed. We're definitely going for really low cost. So this is, on the next slide I can, and we're going low cost so that we can put a sensor in every single room and living space. It's not just one in the hallway, like other places are doing. So this is what they look. This is our very early prototype with a Arduino Uno and a shield. So, and the technology stack that we have on the server is this. When I first wrote the slide, there were a lot more, but we've toned it down. Arduino, which is really accessible. Ruby, because I know a lot of Ruby devs, and it's a perfectly reasonable thing to build a web service in. And Java, because Android made me do that. So the use case is that. Is this my slide or yours?
Yours.
Oh, it's mine. Okay. Yeah. This is a use case. You profile a room. So the idea is not just one reading a day. It's a reading every 30 seconds. We want to make it so that the person can change something and see the change really quickly. You know, 21st century attention spans. Did what I did, did it make an effect? There's a common advice, open the window. This is what landlords say, it's the tenant's fault, they don't open the window. Well, what you can do as a tenant is open the window and see, did it make it better, did it make it worse? Maybe, I read a study saying 75% of houses are improved by opening the window. That's really useful advice unless you live in the other 25%. So you can make this real for yourself. You can work out, is there a better time of day to open the window? And this is relevant to me. I found out that my guest room was dry and my daughter's room was damp.
I was putting her in the room that had the closet. That was the wrong decision. I put her in the dry guest room and she got better. So here's a, this is very high level hand wavy, but how it works. We build a gateway hardware, which is the bigger one on the top right here. The sensor nodes talk to the gateway, and just for funsies, in some places you can proxy. So if the RF can't get through, it can proxy for another sensor. It finally hits the internet at the gateway, which is in the house. We're using MQTT. We happen to be using a service called Cloud MQTT, but we're not tied to them. We have a task that I call ingest because I used to work in the film industry and we called everything an ingest. So the sensor data ingest comes in and it goes into Heroku with Rails and Postgres. Everything chosen so we can change provider really easily. Oh, that's not what I meant to say. No. We have lots of sensors in every room, and we have Wi-Fi on only one unit, and that's the gateway. The reason, oh yeah, so we can, I'm lost. So this is what they cost. Let's go on to this. Wemo's minis cost about $10. These are US dollars, so exchange rate is affecting us. But Wemo's minis cost about $10 on AliExpress. We can print the shield for about a dollar. And you can get a really good transceiver for about $5. So this is how much the gateway costs. So it's a little unit that you plug in. I want to do a shout out to Oshpark. They're the open source hardware circuit printing people. And they make beautiful purple boards. And they gave us a big giant voucher that we're chipping away at. So we actually haven't paid for circuit printing because they're lovely. And I also want to talk about why we chose Arduino boards for this, because they are so cheap, but also the Wi-Fi ones are cheaper, but the Wi-Fi ones give out a whole lot of power, a lot of heat. So if you take a board that is giving out heat and put your temperature sensor on top of it, what's going to happen, right? You're going to be very high and very dry. So there's a lot of projects who are doing this, and they're doing it because they wake it up, take a reading, and then go straight back to sleep. And that's okay. They're not going to do another reading for an hour, so it cools down. Because we weren't doing that, we couldn't. We're doing it every 30 seconds. If I put the temperature sensor there, it would just say everyone's healthy, and it's not the case. This is our sensor node. So Tahi's just Maori for one. So this is Tahi. It was getting Arduino Unos. If I buy them off AliExpress, they're $5. If I buy them in New Zealand, they're more like 30. So that's more than just GST going on there. The shield cost me $15. This was a big mistake. I made it too big. I now know that its size, make it smaller. I found a really cheap transceiver that only cost me 70 cents per transceiver, which seemed to work for a little while. And I got a high quality temperature sensor because I don't want to have to calibrate it. I know that there are 20 cents temperature sensors out there, but that's a lot more work than I want to do. And I want to be accurate without all that labor. So we have this little thing that costs about $25 to build. And these are the shields that we were printing. Initially, I put LEDs on it, and later on, we just took them off. And so we got all these printed. And then we went on to number two. I realized that my little 70-cent transceiver was actually not that great an idea. It was just, they kept just falling out of the network. So we upgraded. We got this. This has got an aerial on it. Anything with an aerial is better than something with that little squiggle on it. The shields, I got them cheaper and smaller. And I took off all the extra things that I was doing. So we got to prototype number two, and we've printed a heap of these now. And for prototype number three, I haven't sent this to the printer yet, but we're doing the same thing. We're using Pro Minis, so it makes it smaller. People really like when their gadgets are small. And the shield is getting smaller and cheaper every time. The temperature sensors went up in price, so I had to adjust this. But I'm going to send this off to Oshpark to print any moment now, and it's going to be about $15.
And so then we were looking at the cost per house. So three bedrooms and two living rooms we want to be able to cover, which is roughly around $75, and one gateway at $16. And so for an entire house, we could do $91 per house. That's excluding, just to clarify, Brenda's time for soldering.
Yep, everyone works for free here.
Yeah. So we are kind of aware that if we were to kind of scale up, that we would need to include those costings in. But with the cheap RF, we could then look at getting a house down to $70.
So we could save $20, but we'll probably end up spending it in, oh my God, why is it not working?
Yeah.
So, you could do a mixture.
And then we've also looked at ways in which we can help cover it. And so this is a case created by Steve Baker, who is sitting in the front.
There he is. Yay. He printed this for us, and he designed this. Oh, yep. Here we go.
So this is it here, and you can come up and touch it and feel it. And we've just found out today that we're more eco-friendly than we're aware of because it's actually compostable.
It's made from corn.
And so this was one of the early prototypes that Steve didn't do, someone else did do, but then this is a high-res photo of what we're looking at. So we need to keep the temperature sensor exposed so that we're not covering it. And what about the power, I hear you ask. So we are currently looking at 5-volt micro USB power supplies, secondhand mostly. So it's the kind donations of people with spare cables. We are looking at battery power, but there are trade-offs with that. So when we then move to battery, if we are measuring every 30 seconds, we then run out of battery a lot quicker. So if we did change to 1-hour readings, that then changes the real-time effect of being able to provide people information. So we're looking at ways in which to make that better.
I think we learned that from, we both volunteered for one laptop per child, and they focused very early on the hand crank and other things, and they were trying to solve all the places where there's no internet, no power. And then about a year later, they realized, hey, why don't we just give them internet and power? So it's that learning. Go for the places where there is internet and power, which covers just about everybody, and then start going on the harder, funner problems. I don't think it will take us long to add a battery. There's heaps of projects out there that do.
Yeah.
But we'll just do the ones with power first.
Yeah. And there are actually people without internet. I know we kind of think everyone has the internet. But in South Auckland, I went to an internet conference, and they basically told me that 60% of people there don't actually have the internet. But those that do are way above the average of people using the internet. And it sounds like everyone's going to someone's house to then use the internet. So it's quite interesting that we're in a place of privilege.
Hmm. And early on, we also talked about having an SD card with the idea that you go collect it. The logistics of that are, we'll solve those later.
We did also talk about buying a van and driving around.
Doing a war drive through my suburb and just collecting it once a week.
Yeah. So if anyone's good at driving and has
If you live in Wellington, you want to drive the van?
Yeah, we'll give you a spare room that you can sleep in. So the interesting thing was that when Brenda was prototyping this in her shared space,
co-working
space, she had some really interesting feedback. So she was coming in the morning and finding that the devices were all unplugged and we couldn't quite work out what was happening. And then she caught someone doing it and they were afraid that it was actually listening to them. So they thought it was a recording device.
So I had it in the meeting rooms and they thought that was the GCSB or something.
And so it's really interesting that we're kind of having to battle against perceptions that Hollywood have kind of put out, because the other option that we had was...
Someone said that to me.
Is it a bomb?
And I had sat down with this person who... and she was just, I can see the wires was the reason she thought it was a bomb. And I mean, we laugh at that, but I think a small number will think that. It's got circuitry exposed. That's not normal. It's suspicious.
So then we're going to talk about the software.
Cool. So, okay, we don't reinvent the wheel. Just like the hardware, we just got a whole of things that already existed and put them together. To do the RF between the sensors, the mesh that's going on, we used a thing from mysensors.org, who I really like, and they did it for us. It's stable, it's reliable, and it's completely open source and well documented. For the transport from the gateway into our database, we're using MQTT, which is really common. I think there's about 50 talks here on MQTT. Everyone's using it now. Cloud MQTT turns out to be quite cheap, and we're using them. It's like RabbitMQ, but less enterprising is my summary. It's nice. We did have it on Mosquito for a while, but Cloud MQTT was cheaper. And Wi-Fi Manager is a library for Arduino. You probably have used it all over the place. If some of the devices that come out on the market with IoT even use it. It just looks like it, I can tell. And if we screenshot it. So you plug in your new gateway on your phone, because we're going the idea people have a phone. Suddenly, Fuddy Gateway appears as a possible Wi-Fi. You click on it, and then this thing pops up on your phone saying, hey, you need to sign in, which, people are used to from... airports,
Did that go to the next slide? Oh, it didn't. There. And then you just configure. We can splash this up and make it branded later, but for now it works. You give it your which Wi-Fi to connect to and password, save. And now the gateway is a gateway for your house. And we use Rails because I know heaps of Rails devs, and it is perfectly reasonable to require a gem and make a model and you're done. So that was nice. Yay, Rails. And Android app is where I'm at now. I started it in my Christmas, because that's what I do at Christmas. And if you want to come help with that, that would be lovely. If you want to come review pull requests, if you want to contribute code, please. We're all on GitHub. Everything is done. Yeah, this is how far we've gotten the Android app. We've got a project. We've got some activities. And we've got a bit of a sitemap that we're working on.
Highly sophisticated UI design work there.
So
then I just wanted to talk about what we kind of achieved in the past year, because if nothing else, it's to kind of remind ourselves that we've actually done a fair bit. So in February last year, Brenda and I sort of started talking about low-cost sensors for housing and what that could kind of look like. Thank you, Daniel. In May, we then created a Slack channel, and we kind of had lots of people volunteering, which was amazing, and
Some
so we kind
of
pulled them together. We actually, in May as well, got the Tadeo name officially approved. In June, we actually met with our local council. So one of the things that we're doing is kind of trying to revalidate all the time that this is a valid project and that this is needed. And we're also of the opinion that if when we are no longer needed, we should shut this down. So we met with our local council, who kind of confirmed that we're on the right track and that there is a need for this. In October, we actually became a registered charity, which was a lot and lot of paperwork, but we got there. And in December, we had the boards printed for prototyping in our houses.
So far, we're self-funding, but we're now looking for to get larger numbers of sensors going on.
And our plan kind of for 2017 is to get it working. We kind of have various tests out there at the moment, but we want to extend it out to kind of our close family and friends. And then feedback and changes that we need to make. And our kind of step two was to look at social housing for a suburb in one kind of location, and we're trying to get that in before winter so that we can start to take measurements during the winter period. And then we actually want to look at a social housing in a separate city, because dealing with city councils is going to be quite interesting, and we just want to look at the different processes that we have to do for that. And we kind of already have a lot of iwi in New Zealand have kind of approached us, and we've kind of just said, can we just install it in Wellington first properly?
I don't know what's the English for iwi.
Tribe,
I guess. Yep.
Yeah. So just to start with who we are. So these are the trustees of Whare Hauora, the charity. So you have myself, Brenda, and Hiria Tarangi, who describes herself as an Indigi nerd, which I didn't know that hashtag existed until she told me, so that's pretty awesome, and hopefully she's listening
she's
on live stream.
Yep.
But we also want to acknowledge that we can't do anything without our volunteers, who we love very much. And so we're currently at the moment trying to look at diversity reporting on our volunteers, who they are, trying to share some information about their ethnicity, their age, and who's part of that group. And we'd appreciate it if you want to come and help us as well. And I found this GIF, which is amazing. That dude's here. So we'd like to shout out as well to Rabbit Technologies in Wellington and Osh Park.
So Rabbit's my employer, and they've given me a lot of work paid time to work on this. So that's...
Yeah, and so they have innovation time, and I get to hang out with them, and they pretty much welcome me with open arms. I feel like I'm an honorary employee. So this is kind of a quote that I love, which is, be the change that you wish to see in the world, so how will you change the world?
Cool.
Questions?
Cool, oh, hands up.
Thank you, that was great. Okay, and so we do have some time for some questions. Please raise your hand. Remember that it does need to be in the form of a question, and wait for us to bring you a mic.
Hello. You said that you're looking for volunteers. What is the best way for people to contact you, volunteer, et cetera, et cetera?
Cool. You can get them.
This website actually has a volunteer form on, so if you just submit it, then we can...
Just
Does that show up?
We'll collect it.
Cool. And feel free to, a pull request review would be really valuable. We've got a lot of, I like that two coders look at code before it goes in. And we do have a lot of volunteers who are on their own. So, and then it sort of sits there, no one says anything, and then we merge it. So if you just want to have opinions and reckons on the internet, come review our pull requests, okay?
Yes.
So how many installs do you have so far? And
They're all friends of the project right now. We haven't gone public with people that we've met through this. We have an installation in my house, and we have an installation in a co-working space right now. And your house is next. So
yeah, we're expanding it out to kind of family and friends so we can collect more data.
Yeah, we have a schedule before winter, basically.
Okay, thank you. That was a great presentation. I have plenty of technical questions, but I actually have another question relating to the so you're gathering data, and I totally get what you're doing. Is that data actionable? So what happens when a tenant points out, okay, you know, I'm below this temperature threshold? So what are you going to do with this?
There are existing advocates for people in bad housing. They're not getting very far right now. So basically, we're not taking on the battle. We're giving them more data.
Yeah.
So that's not, because it's not our expertise.
And evidence as well. So Brenna, like,
yeah,
I think last month got a request from her old landlord who was like,
cool story.
Hey, these tenants have just moved in and said the house is terrible. What did you?
Yeah, tell me it wasn't terrible for you. And I said, well, actually, I have some log files. And I emailed it to them.
Yeah.
Yeah, and their reply was, thanks.
And I think we've also had feedback from councils as well that a lot of this information can help them kind of provide information back to the national government about how bad the situation is, or not. Maybe we prove that it's not as bad as everyone thinks. I don't think that's going to happen.
It might happen, though. I mean, we do have houses that are right next to each other, and if one of them will be owner-occupied, another one will be provided by the government, another one provided by the city council, and they're all right next to each other and ought to have the same sun and warmth and weather, and yet one is damp and one is healthy. So it's taking some things out of the variables out of the equation.
Can you tell me what radio frequency you were using between the sensors and the gateway?
Yes, that's a good question. The same one as Wi-Fi. That's a very good nerdy question. So we're using 2.4 gigahertz Wi-Fi and 2.4 gigahertz for our mesh network, the exact same frequency. And it's working. The Wi-Fi is good at sharing with other noise, and the radios we're using are so fast that time sharing, they're just fine. It might be a problem later, but it's not yet.
I actually have a couple of questions. The first is, so that one there, is that just a temperature sensor? Doesn't have combined humidity?
It's temperature and humidity.
Oh, it does have humidity. Cool. Do you find that placement of these sensors also affects it? Because I'm imagining, like, if you go further to the ceiling, it'll be warmer.
Yes. So we're going to get scientists to tell us where, but my own testing has found you put it in the shelf of a bookshelf, it's colder. You put it this height, it's where I prefer it. If you put it on top of the power supply, it's nice and warm. There's all sorts of variables in there. You're leaving it in a sunny window is another thing that you shouldn't do. So yeah, the placement is important. We are going to get someone who is an expert in that to tell us what to do. We have them, we just haven't had the time.
And I mean, we're taking on feedback all the time. So Steve gave us this wonderful prototype of the case here, which you can all look and touch and hopefully not break. But talking with Nat, we just discussed about how if this is in rental properties, they don't want to stick it on the wall or anything like that. So maybe we can have a picture hook kind of printed into it so that we'll be able to hang it on the wall without interfering with anything.
So this is very much not a product announcement. It's an open source project announcement. It's like we have this 80% built thing. So please come help us.
Okay, we have time for a few more questions.
He's forgotten his question. Oh. No.
So the rental market in Tasmania is also pretty shocking, and we have plenty of cold, mouldy houses, some of which I've lived in, and it was very unpleasant. Have you got thoughts in the future of expanding, like, internationally across the pond?
Not ourselves. GitHub has a fork button that you can use. But yeah, everything is straight to GitHub. Like, you know, the code's half an hour old when I push. You know. So you're very welcome to do it again.
And we'd be keen to kind of share our policies as well around data privacy. So us as trustees are pretty transparent. So everything that we're looking to do as part of those policies, we look to publish on our website as well. So
I just wanted to ask, is the hardware available? And have you thought of selling the hardware to help finance the project?
With this you can do that one.
Okay, so what we've kind of looked at is, so we've applied for a fund in New Zealand, and as part of that, we kind of have to look at, sorry, I can't see where you are, but I'm assuming you're up there. Oh, there. And as part of it, we kind of have to be self-funding, which is kind of a little bit hard as a charity, but what we are trying to do is look at, we've had heaps of people who are very privileged and can afford to pay for this. So we're looking at models where if you buy one, we'd gift one to a social housing project. Yeah.
Kia ora, Henare up the back here. My question is, you said that you've established a charity. I'd like to know what the necessity of that was. Like, why did you start? What did you find the need to create an organization without just kind of doing it? And also, what was the overhead of creating an organization? You know, did it kind of get in the way of you just building tech and getting out there and, you know, getting this data? Thanks.
It didn't really get in the way of doing the tech because Hidea and I kind of did all the paperwork and we left Brenda to run. And then I kind of popped in and just made sure that she was okay from a tech perspective. I think it was really just setting a clear expectation that we're not trying to make money off of it, and that the rules around charities is that you have to put the money back in unless you've got fancy accountants who can do some money funneling, which
we're not doing
really
that.
Doing.
I think it's because we're handling money.
Yeah.
Wanted to do it in a transparent manner.
And every time you ask for funding as well, it just kind of sets a clear expectation. Like, there are tax rebates and stuff like that that people who give us money can do. But I think from our perspective, it was just making sure that we are right from the get-go, we're doing this and we're wanting to put the money back into it. We're not going to have fancy houses.
They required us to write the objectives of this of the charity, which was a really good process to go through, and it had to meet the Charities Act, which is a reasonably well thought out set of criteria. It had to make it clear that we weren't doing it for our own benefit.
Yeah, and the overhead, however, is the accounting aspect, so we do have to prove our accounts at the end of it. But what we've kind of do is sign up to an online accounting agency, Xero, someone may have heard of that. And so we're putting everything through there.
So it's robots are doing it for us?
Yeah. Yep. And hopefully I just press print and a nice report comes out.
So looking at the hardware evolution, you're clearly looking to miniaturize and reduce cost. Currently, the architecture is based on an Arduino module with a shield. Are you looking to combine that all onto a single low-cost board and then mass-produce that in quantities that will allow you to purchase parts for potentially cents instead of dollars to further reduce the cost?
If you know how to do that, please come and help. I don't have a pick-and-place machine. I'm soldering it myself. I didn't have that. If you know somewhere that's got cheap pick-and-place for small batches and stuff, that would be interesting.
Also bearing in mind that we're in New Zealand and not like the US, so in terms of the, like, I'm not sure as to how much you would have to buy to be able to get at that low cost, but.
Yeah, we're looking at sort of deployments of like maybe 400 in a run sort of thing. I made that number up, it sounded good.
Yeah. You had me full.
Yeah, we've got time for a couple more questions.
Oh, there's one at the back.
There's one down here. Oh, like literally.
He's on the mountain.
Hi.
Hello.
Hello. Thanks very much. Wonderful presentation and wonderful project. I have a quick question. Say, what if, let's tell me the background. So I used to be a PhD student working in a corner of a lab, and the lab was a corner of a building of a university. So it was quite damp, and I used to get sick, and I wish I would have this device at time. I could measure the moisture. The question is, what if the tenant gathers this temperature and all these things, all this data, and he wants to complain to somebody? What if the complainer listens to the complaint and it says, I don't care about this data, it could be wrong. So is there any standardization or something like that? Like when I buy that $300 device from Harvey Norman or somewhere, there'd be like a standardization of the data. But for your case, is there like, do you follow any standardization to check if the data is correct or not?
I think the one you get from Harvey Norman is just got the same standards as we have. It's some person in a factory's put a temperature sensor in a fully sealed case, and the case of the expensive ones I got. So I don't see any difference between the two.
Yeah.
And I would argue that.
Every sensor will have a variance, and we believe that the sensors that we've got at a cheaper rate have enough variance that we're happy to trade that off and be able to tell people the information to be able to help them do things.
But someone advocating for their own, for everyone in the street to get better housing is a secondary goal. It's to empower the resident first to make decisions about their house, because that's something they can do now. They don't have the government pushing back on that. Sorry, I shouldn't have said that.
Also, if their landlord is maybe not acknowledging the information that they've kind of put in, that maybe they might want to move house and get another landlord.
So I think the people who live in the cheapest, awfulest housing don't really have the power to get their house fixed. And I do not know at this time how to help them. Yep. What I can do is help them to pick to move to another bedroom, to open a window, to try this, to try that. So that's the change we can do.
Yeah.
And everything else is secondary, and there are other people already working in the space that we want to help.
Yeah. And maybe as well, like, because the window is a good example, so opening the window, but also correlating that with like weather information, because I don't know if you know Wellington, it's quite windy sometimes, and in fact there's a weather bomb that's hitting it right
170
now.
At my house right now.
Yeah.
Kilometers per hour.
Maybe opening a window might not be so good because you might lose your window. So just offering other advice maybe during those times.
So with respect to the question that was asked just before this one, let's say you did find a way of taking advantage of economies of scale, getting these things printed, put together quickly. How rapidly could you scale up to take advantage of that, do you think?
Don't know. People talk about manufacturing, and manufacturing through some of the factories in China is a web form that you upload nowadays. So I think it would be fast. But I think it comes back to getting to know the residents rather than mass producing saying you shall do it. So I expect us to be small for the next year at least.
And the user experience behind that as well, because the people that we're aiming at, like they might look at the screen of data that Brenda had and just be totally confused. And so what we're trying to do is add the sort of human experience behind it, whereas this is actually bad. You should not have people in this room. And we're also trying to leverage our rural areas. There's not a lot of jobs out there. It is declining. And so being able to give them the empowerment to be able to make these devices, teach their kids this, have kids in schools making these, will come and teach you how to do it. And then you can actually put it in your home, measure it, and start sharing with your family this information. So
I think we have time for one more quick question. We have about a minute left.
Lucky me. Really quickly, just going back on your other point about the weather you mentioned, are you doing anything to correlate the data to the weather outside and what the difference between inside and outside is?
Yes, so I had a play 2 weeks ago with some formulas and just imported Python libraries, but that's a formula, on how to calculate the probability of mould growth. And the three factors I saw, you needed the inside temperature, the outside temperature, and the inside humidity. So for the suburb that we are looking at first is the suburb I live in, so I'm like, we're working where we live, and we're right next to the airport, and the airport has a weather station, so I can get the temperature pretty close to what's at that house, and temperature inside the house, and the humidity inside the house, and tell them there is a greater than 99% chance that this room has mold. Some of the formulas are coming out.
Right. Thank you. That was a really great talk, and thank you for speaking with us today. And you can track them down later, hopefully in the hallway track, or follow up with them online. So thank you so much.
Cool.